You're listening to the number one fitness, health, and entertainment podcast. This is Mind Pump. Now, in today's episode, we answer the fitness and health questions that are asked by our audience. We actually answered four questions, but the way we open the episode is with an introductory portion. This is where we talk about our sponsors, we tell stories, we bring up studies, we have a lot of fun. Today's intro portion was 41 minutes. After that, we answered the fitness questions. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go through this episode and kind of break down all the stuff that we talked about.
Give us the breakdown.
So we opened up by talking about a new product from Organifi called Harmony. This is for women to help them with PMS symptoms, hormone balance, and improved libido. It's an interesting product. You can go try it out and use the Mind Pump discount code to get 20% off. Go to Organifi.com/Mind Pump and then use the code Mind Pump for that 20% off.
Let's harmonize.
Then we talked about scented candles getting 1-star reviews from people who can't smell them because they have COVID. That sucks.
Ooh.
Justin talked about a new rub he made for his grass-fed meat with coffee. Believe it or not, you can use coffee grounds to make your meat taste delicious. And the meat that he used was from ButcherBox. ButcherBox delivers grass-fed meat to your door at amazing prices. It's one of our favorite companies. And because you listen to Mind Pump, you get an exclusive discounted offer. Go check it out. Go to butcherbox.com/Mind Pump and go see what they have set up for you. Then we talk about the stimulus bill numbers that are going to other countries. That's great. Mm. We talk about how Santa Claus, as we imagine him, how that was invented by Coca-Cola back in 1931.
Looks like he drank all the Coca-Cola.
Yeah, made Santa fat. Then we talked about Jon Favreau, one of our favorite directors right now. We brought up the new boxing trend with social media influencers putting on gloves.
Dude, face palm.
We talked about asset inflation that we predict to be happening with all this printed money. And then we talked about Apple making a car. That's going to be kind of interesting. Mm. Then we got into the questions. Here's the first one. This person wants to know, what are some of the best workout splits that you can do for your body? The next one, this person wants to know what you can do on a rest day when you still want to go to the gym. The third question, this person wants to know, what do you do if you're too sick to work out? Or how do you know if you're too sick to work out?
Stay home.
And the final question, what did 2020 teach you? Also, right now, this is kind of cool. If you go to mindpumpstore.com and you buy a $100 apparel gift card, so a gift card that can buy any Mind Pump apparel or workout equipment, we have that stuff on there as well, you'll get a free MAPS workout program of your choice. This makes for a great gift. It's awesome for yourself. You get a bunch of cool clothes, or you can get a suspension trainer, some resistance bands, plus a free MAPS program. Now, for everyone else, if you want to follow a long-term system or program, check out our new bundles. They actually are going to continue going on. We still have them going on. And these bundles are for beginners, intermediate, or advanced lifters. The first one is for beginners. It's 9 months of exercise programming. It's called the New to Weightlifting Bundle. The second one for intermediate lifters, also 9 months of your workouts planned out for you, is the Body Transformation Bundle. And the third one is for advanced lifters. This one's called the New Year Extreme Intensity Bundle. It's also 9 months of your workouts planned out. By the way, all these come with a year of access to our private forum for free, so you can ask questions and you can talk to your favorite hosts of Mind Pump because we're on there as well. And they all come with a 30-day money-back guarantee. By the way, this particular promotion, these are the final hours. This is what we're doing for the end of 2020, so take advantage now. You can learn more about these bundles at mapsdecember.com. Organifi is hitting it out of the park again. Did you see what they just did?
What?
They did a new product for women called Harmony to balance out hormones and boost libido. They didn't say boost libido, but I saw the ingredients, and that's what's going to happen.
Really?
Really?
Yeah, it's got maca in there, chasteberry.
Oh, God bless you, Organifi.
Other ingredients that...
Like, all the men buying it?
No.
Merry Christmas. Stocking stuffers.
Yeah. Merry Christmas, right. Honey.
Yeah.
This is for you.
Is the bottle colored feminine or masculine? What's it look like?
I'm trying to remember.
I would think it might be a little feminine.
Yeah.
That'd be my guess.
Well, but maca boosts libido in women and balances out hormones. So does chasteberry, balances out hormones. And there's some other ingredients in there.
Chasteberry.
But you're really marketing to the men, let's be honest. That's why I want to know what it looks like.
I feel like you're going to lose if you buy that for your, you know what I mean? You think so? She's like, thanks. And then she reads it and it's like, you know, balance out hormones. Boost libido.
Yeah, what are you trying to tell me?
Imagine if your girl brought you something.
Does it say,
here, honey, I brought you this supplement. It's like, you know, erectiloid or whatever. Yeah. Erectiloid. Yeah, yeah.
Some increase penis size, but
this is for your problem. Yeah. Yeah. Like, oh, man.
This will make you hornier. Excuse me?
Yeah.
What's going on here? Anyway, they're knocking it out of the park.
Yeah.
That's their balance product.
No, that's balanced. That's not harmony.
Yeah, yeah.
I know they
yeah.
sound similar.
Balance, harmony.
Yeah.
Yeah, alignment.
I love, exactly. I love messing with Doug when he's on the
scrambling over there. Scrambling.
All of a sudden, he's on eHarmony now.
There it is.
There's his profile.
Yeah, feminine. I think they should have made it masculine.
Why?
Or neutral.
So here's what it says. It says a nourishing chocolate blend that supports balancing my hormones and reducing my cramps, bloating, and PMS. And that is what those ingredients do for sure. Now, knowing that, you buy that for your girl, you might get in trouble.
You might get in trouble, yeah.
I don't know. With a name like Harmony, I feel like I could give that to Katrina, and she'd be like, oh, that's sweet of you, honey. She doesn't read the back of
those things. Just put a candle right next to it. Be like, here.
Come on, she doesn't read the back of
those. It's my offering.
You're like, babe, we need you a little bit more harmonious. Speaking of candle, oh, my God, dude. So there's this scented candle company. I can't remember the name of it. But they're getting these one-star reviews.
Is that the same one that did What's-Her-Face's Vagina Smell?
No.
Remember that?
Gwyneth Paltrow?
Oh, yeah, that's
from
who it was.
From the Goop.
Yeah. What the fuck was that
That
all
was
about?
Hilarious.
Dude, it was scented a troll vagina. Move that I'm sure she got a bunch of money from.
Yeah, didn't she make millions off of that?
I think so.
Yeah.
Now, you want to talk about sexism. Okay.
It smells like my vagina.
Could you make millions selling a candle that smells like dick?
No, nobody's in the...
I don't think it's sexist. I just think that,
in the business for that.
Yeah, I just don't think...
Nobody wants to smell dick.
Yeah, nobody does.
No, even if it was The Rock. You know what I mean? The Rock's cock.
Wow.
Sorry, Doug.
I don't know.
Anyway, the scented candle company.
Doug's like, I have two of those. Like,
yeah, I know. I take the cock candle.
If you smell my candle.
And the vagina candle, and I put them together. Anyway, that's how The Rock knew he had COVID, by the way.
What? Oh,
Nobody could smell what he was cooking.
Wow.
Oh,
I feel like
God, man, terrible.
Along those lines, there's a scented candle company. It's getting a bunch of one-star reviews because they can't smell it because they have COVID.
That's not why.
Yes.
You lie.
I swear they're getting one-star reviews, and then the people are coming back and saying, oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, sorry.
I had COVID. That's why I couldn't smell it.
Really?
Yes, dude.
Now, we talked about this on the show, the coffee test, right?
Yeah, that was the one.
Was it 70 or 80%?
I think like 80% of people with COVID will lose their sense of smell and taste.
That's interesting.
As a result. By the way.
Speaking of coffee, I was going to bring something. Have you guys tried a coffee rub on a steak before?
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. So is it good?
Traeger has one.
Oh, it's so good.
It's really good.
So it sounds weird to me. Coffee with
It's like
meat.
Chili powder and there's like garlic. And, I mean, yeah, you add a bunch of other kind of spices, but the actual coffee grounds, it just helps like, I don't know, like it like ingrains a lot of those flavors into the steak.
Did you make the rub yourself or buy it?
No, yourself.
Oh, you made it?
Yeah.
What did you do?
Well, I mean, I'm not the best on ingredients and whatnot, so I'll have to look this up. But
I don't know.
Courtney made it.
Well, she made. Yeah, dude, she did. But I mean, I cooked it.
And take credit.
I'm not trying to take credit. Credit's where credit's due. Yeah. She put it together. But it was delicious.
I clearly heard you said you made it. That's what
did
I heard.
Did I say that? Oh, that's just something I do. Anyways,
I mean, we're one, right? So I always tell Katrina when I take credit for her shit, I'm just like, well, we're one. Yeah. We're the same. You know,
but what's up, bad? Exactly. Happens. You gotta take the responsibility, honey.
So you got ancho chili powder, you got finely ground coffee beans, which we had from Pete's, and then teaspoons of brown sugar, and then you got hot smoked Spanish paprika, and a bunch of other stuff in there. But yeah,
you take that and you rub that on the meat?
Yeah, just rub it on the meat.
Do you leave it, or do you just go right to the grill after that?
30 minutes, bro.
At least, yeah.
30 minutes is like, dry rub is about 30 minutes.
Wow, I know, you're weird.
I mean, we've had a few hours before.
Adam, you're so precise with meat stuff. It's so weird.
So precise about meat stuff.
You are, dude. You're like, the temperature, we're at this altitude, so you gotta do this long.
Doug's the meat guy, man. I take heat.
You know, what's the difference? It's the cook and the chef, right? So, like, the cook is the one that's, like, very precise every single time.
No, the chef.
Oh, the chef, right.
Yeah.
So, I'm more the cook. I'm the one that's, like, out there, like, messing with it. to, you know, and like that
was,
on a rhythm.
That was Doug's stage name, by the way. The what? Meat guy the back
meat,
in the day.
The meat guy?
Before I met him.
Big meat guy? We've got the big gym guy sweaters that are meat. Out. It's the big meat guy. Maybe we'll roll that out next.
What did you put that rub on, Justin?
Yeah, so I put it on the steak tips.
Oh, and steak tips.
Steak tips
this is the grass
tri-tip.
Really?
Yeah.
And is it better than when you would do a normal, you know, like salt, pepper, garlic?
Way better.
Did you get steak tips from Butcher Box or did you make those?
Yeah, no, we got that from Butcher Box.
So I didn't know they had that too. They have steak tips already like that?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Damn,
you gotta check, dude.
It's really good.
You know what?
They add stuff all the time.
I know, I'm really bad about it. I set our box, basically the way we did it was like off of what we use every month. Mm. So that's why I was looking at them.
What do you get? Ground beef, I'm assuming.
Yep, ground beef. We get chicken thighs. I normally get the I always forget the name of the. Is it the shoulder, Doug? Is it the one I was talking about?
The sirloin cap.
Yes, cap. The cap. Thank you.
I know. I always forget that one.
Yeah.
Too.
So the cap, and then there's something. Oh, and the ribeyes. So those are kind of like the staple.
I go ground beef, ribeye, tri-tip, and then I'll get the pork.
You guys still haven't done the pork. No, I'm not a big. The bacon is about the only. Bro, and I do bacon. Of course.
I'm telling you right now, I do not like. I'm not a pork guy. I don't like pork meat unless it's bacon. I don't like ham. I don't like pork chops. Their pork is incredible. It's really good.
I know you've been selling it since the day one. I gotta get on that.
I promise you.
Doug, you do a lot of pork?
I do some. I do ribs mainly.
Yeah. Oh, okay. So I get the ribs too. That's the other thing I love from there.
Oh, yeah.
Interesting.
Yeah.
I'm
doing that next.
What were you messing around with? You told me yesterday. What were you?
The sirloin cap.
Okay. So you were messing with that.
Yeah. And the smoker. It's so tasty. It has a big layer of fat on it.
Yeah.
And that tastes really good.
Speaking of which, you guys with the sous vide, you know what I just read? Somebody sent me a study.
Did you get one finally?
No, I haven't got one yet.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm waiting for Christmas. I thought one of you guys would buy me one.
That already passed.
Yeah,
you're fucked. Next year? Yeah.
Apparently.
Yeah, gotta wait till Christmas 2021. So I read this study that said that cooking your meat in the sous vide makes the protein more digestible and essentially you'll assimilate more of it in the body.
That's interesting.
Isn't it? So theoretically, now I don't have the study in front of me. Okay, it was actually a study. I don't have it in front of me, so I can't quote off of it. But with this, from what I read, what I remembered, essentially, if you eat a lot of protein, one of the challenges sometimes is digestion, because a lot of protein can sometimes slow down motility. Well, it would theoretically then cooking your meat with a sous vide would make it so that you could eat more protein or less protein and utilize more of it more effectively.
So now, that brings up the old argument that we talk about, and we've brought it up on the show before, of there's no such thing as like eating too much protein in one sitting. Mm-hmm. So like,
well, I mean, there is at some point, right?
Well, and I think that's what's missing in that conversation. Like I know, I think Lane addressed it I saw one of his videos like a month or two ago and you know, a part of the science community mocks that, right? And we've mocked that. Like, oh, you know, it's like, it's not like it disappears and just goes nowhere. Right. You get those calories. Yeah. And so.
But if your digestion gets thrown off,
well, that's
the limit.
Right. And if you guys ever ate 80 or 90 grams of protein in one sitting, no. I mean, I'm on the toilet right afterwards.
It's
you
like a brick. Yeah.
I can't imagine that if I take 80 grams in one sitting and I'm on the toilet within 5 minutes of eating it is the same as if I take that same 80 grams and I divide it in three meals.
No, of course not. Of course not, because you got a bunch of inflammation going on. Your body's responding in a way that's not favorable. It's not going to be conducive to not just health, but your goals, your fitness goals, right? You know what's funny, though, about protein? I have, my digestion's always, whatever you want to call it, weak. But when it comes to meat and protein, I can consume a tremendous amount at a single sitting. So I can have a pound. I've had a pound and a half of meat at one sitting, and I'm fine. So when I throw in the other stuff, that's when I got to be careful.
Yeah. So I max out at about 70, 75 with that. And same thing, Sal. If I do it if I'm doing it's like a vegetable and meat, I'm fine. If I add it with a carb.
Yes, then you're fucked, huh?
Yeah.
Yeah, me too.
Then 70 grams is even pushing it. Mm-hmm. So 40 to 50 feels the best on my digestion. I feel like I can assimilate that fine. I don't have any issues. I'm not running the toilet. If I do something where I'm pushing 75 plus, and especially if I have some sort of a carb in there, besides like a vegetable, like I definitely
feel.
Then
it's no good.
Yeah.
Yeah. Hey, I want to congratulate you guys, by the way. Today's the third day in a row we've worked out at the same time.
Yeah. No, we're higher than three.
Good team.
It's like day four or five. What are you, new here, guy?
Hold on a second. Go ahead, Doug.
It's day six. I don't know.
Yeah.
It's day three in a row.
Well, okay. Right. We don't get to count last week.
I guess
so. You don't.
We had a break.
Yeah.
What is it? No.
Weekends?
Did you break?
No. No,
I didn't break either. So come on, guy.
The most days we've done in a row is three.
Well, then the most we'll ever be able to do is five.
Exactly.
Stupid.
Anyway. Stupid. Whatever.
We're on a roll.
You're right. We are. Yeah. And I'm proud.
I was going to say, that was a terrible congratulations.
It was. I'm sorry. But the bottom line is, I'm very proud. This is great. I'm having a lot of fun with you guys, man.
I like to celebrate things that we do.
Yeah. Let's all pat each other.
Yeah.
No, but it's fun. I've been having a good time with you guys.
It has been fun.
Yeah. No. The workouts have been great. And it's so how ironic is it that you got three, personal trainers, been training for as long as we have, buddies, we see each other every single day, yet in 6 years you can, now you can count on two hands how many times we've
Also I'm noticing about it that's good is it where we can almost do meetings at the same time. We have conversations that normally we would do when we're working. But we can do while we're working out. So
it's funny. It almost felt like nostalgic at first. It's like, oh, yeah, I remember when we used to do this and like work out, together the more. And then it's like, oh, we're still doing this.
Yeah. It's a good time. Dude, you guys want to hear something hilarious? You know how I brought up that stimulus bill a couple times?
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the one okay, so do you want to know? So someone did the math. This economist did the math. Here's some interesting statistics with it. So it was a $900 billion stimulus package, right? For $900 billion, if they gave it all to individuals, so if they didn't give it to overseas countries and all that stuff, they just gave it to people, they could have given every U.S. household a check for $7,000. Okay? They only cut checks to households that experienced unemployment, then that number would have been $30,000.
Wow.
Yeah, but instead there was $600.
So the $7,000, does that include everybody?
That's every household.
Like so us too?
I think it's every, I don't know. It just, this is an economist.
Dude, that's exactly what I would want to happen.
Yeah.
You know, for people unemployed, those are the ones that need it.
Yeah. But Pakistan needed $10 million for I don't know what it was. Gender stuff. That's what it said. Yeah. Okay. Pakistan gets
That is so weird to me that we're sending millions of dollars overseas.
It's special interest. It's all special interest stuff. So when something like this happens and they're able to pass a big thing, they'll make a huge bill. They'll give you 6 hours to pass it. And buried inside of it is money for their friends in other places. Because it might say, $15 million to help whatever country with – poverty, but reality, we're just giving it to their government and then they can decide to do what they want with it. Usually what they do is they buy military stuff either back from us.
Yeah.
So they'll get the $10 million to buy
this
tanks from us.
This was the problem with 2020. Yeah. It was just being forced to watch like all of the normal transactions that these politicians are responsible for.
Oh, that's a good time.
I'm ready for it to be over.
I'm so ready.
Hey, I know Christmas is over, but I was reading this thing on Santa Claus I thought was really interesting. I want to share with you. Did you know that Coca-Cola is responsible for the image of what Santa Claus looks like to us?
I read that once.
Isn't that interesting?
So what we think of Santa, I did read that once.
Yeah, the rosy cheeks, the big white beard, the big belly.
What did they think of him before?
I don't remember what I read. I don't know if they said so. It was in 1931, I think,
because he had Father Christmas, right? Was that the one that was before that? And then,
so they actually pulled from, I want to say, a Charles Dickens his description from a book, and then created an illustrated
Carol or whatever.
Yeah, it was something like that. I can't remember what it was. It was, and then that's how they came up with the illustration. But the whole big belly, jolly, rosy cheeks, and all that came from Coca-Cola.
So I just pulled up. I just went online and I did.
Drinking a ton of Cokes.
I typed in, Doug, you might want to do this. Santa Claus 1900, and then look at the pictures. I'm so glad Coca-Cola made this look better.
What was it like?
Creepy.
It looks more like a homeless dude.
Homeless guy in the trees.
Yeah, Doug, pull it up and pull up images.
Let me see.
You could see what Santa used to look like. It was kind of terrifying in some of these pictures.
He looked like an old wizard.
Yeah, they do. Yeah, look at that first picture. He wasn't even fat though. Look at that. He wasn't jolly or anything.
Yeah.
Then he drank Coke, and look what happened.
Yeah.
Now we have diabetes.
He's
kind of
like a carny. He looks a little bit like you travel.
There it is, right there.
Sideshows.
We like Santa to be obese. That's the way we.
How
like
interesting.
A hipster carny.
I thought that was so interesting though. That's something that a brand, a soda brand, came up with something that we all celebrate and we just take as the norm today.
It's really interesting to me. I still was like, my mind was boggled with the whole Elf on the Shelf thing. And I'm like, and this like was readily accepted by like everybody. And
all
this,
of a sudden.
Yeah. I'm like, what? This is totally how these things just happen. You know, everybody's just like, oh, this is the thing now.
That's a good point, right? Like 30, 40 years from now, it'll be like everybody has to do Elf on the Shelf. It's like a mandatory thing.
I refuse
thing.
To
yeah,
do it.
Dude.
Oh, you don't do it?
No, I don't do
it. You do it, don't you?
Yeah, but I've been like, it's just because my youngest, he's still kind of like.
So I need schooling from both of you then because I think.
If you start it, you got
to
do it.
Well, that's what everybody says. Commit. Once you start it, you got to commit to it. It looks funny and fun.
It's kind of fun because it's. Every you know, day you see you him talking him? To him and like, I don't know. He's not like, I mean, he still really believes in Santa and all that. And it's great. And his brother's trying to keep it, keep it alive for us and stuff, which I appreciate. But yeah, the Elf on the Shelf thing, I've never been that into it other than sometimes I'll put him like in a TIE fighter or something and like have him exploding and, you know, or like just like situations where, you know, you can make creative like fun with it.
Yeah, but you got to commit to changing.
You got to do it every time. It's exhausting.
Yeah. So my daughter, now that we have a baby, now she's okay with admitting that she knows Santa's not real. Because I think now she realizes she's going to get a Santa gift no matter what, you know?
Oh, really?
So all of a sudden she's like, yeah, I know.
So I plan to cut him off as soon as my son stops believing. That's like that's how I want to teach him. So I'm going to say, so every year we'll do like a gift from Santa Claus, right? That come, and then when he gets to that age, when he's a little bit older and he starts questioning it, Dad, is Santa for real? My answer to that will be only if you believe. If you don't believe, he's not real, son. So if you don't believe.
Yeah, but he's your kid, dude. He's smart. He'll be like, I believe till he's 20 years old.
So I don't know. Yeah, exactly. So
then he gets a gift. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, my oldest, like, so he obviously kind of figured all this stuff out, and so our thing was to like bring him in, and so he is like the Santa now, and he does it for his brother, and like so he does all.
Oh, that's
for
nice.
His brother.
That's a great idea.
So yeah, so that actually worked out. That was Courtney's idea. Again, I'll give her credit.
Well, see, now that's what we're gonna do with Aurelius now because his older siblings are a lot older, right? My daughter's 11, my son's 15.
Yeah.
So it's gonna be fun now because I'm gonna tell the kids, all right, we need to make this as believable as possible. So you know, do the hoof prints and the cookies and
it's just fun, man.
Maybe I'm thinking about doing like the camera. You know, we'll set up a camera.
Did you?
And I'll dress up so that he sees. That.
Did you ever see the Elf on the Shelf thing? That video
that was
went viral. That was hilarious, dude. Yeah. That was so. I don't know how the parents did that, but they.
Or it was almost like Blair Witch.
Yes, they made him. Like they made him cut. Yeah, they made him. I don't know. They probably used like some fishing line that was like clear or whatever, and it's like black and white camera. I know those cameras aren't that good of quality, so it just looks like he moves across the living room, and then it looks like all of a sudden you see him disappear because he's underneath the camera, and then all of a sudden he has a sheet and he throws it over the throws it over the camera. And you can't
see that was next level, dude. I got him good one time because like I had a Sonos, so it was like. Like every time he'd ask the elf something, like it would play Christmas music, you know, and then turn it off after, you know, like so it was like going back and forth with it, and he was like tripping out.
Oh, dude, I used to play games like that with my kids where I'd be at the stoplight and then it'd be red, but you know, you could tell when it's gonna turn green by looking at the other lights.
Yeah.
So I'd tell him like, watch this, I got magic, and then I'd snap my finger, it would turn green. And my kids, for the longest time, were just they were tripping out. They were like,
"That's so funny." I do the same
like,
thing, but,
I
do the whole like Jedi, like you know,
yeah, you watch Daddy use the Force.
Yeah. I do that a few times. It didn't last long. They didn't believe me after.
It'd be funny because we'd be stopped at a red light, and my son would be like, "Come on, do it!" And I'm like, "I don't feel like it."
And I'd be use watching your powers, Dad.
I'd be watching the light. I don't feel. All right, fine. And then it turned green. You know, like, oh my god. How did you do that? You know? Yeah. Hey, speaking of elf stuff, so you know John Favreau, right? He
love that guy.
He directed Elf,
mm-hmm.
which became an instant classic. I saw this whole thing about appreciation for him.
Mm-hmm.
Iron Man, which he basically completely created that whole franchise because he's such a good job with Iron Man.
Yeah,
and then Star Wars.
Yep,
and he did such a good job with Star Wars that people are realizing how shitty all the other ones are.
Exactly, 100%. No, you're totally accurate with that.
Serious, you guys got to watch. God damn, there's this, let's see, the Christmas movies that made us on Netflix.
Oh, yeah.
And there's an episode on Elf, and it goes into Jon Favreau. And this is when he was a nobody.
Mm-hmm.
And so you remember those stop motion Christmas shows that were on when we were kids?
Yeah.
There was like Frosty the Snowman.
There was that one, Rudolph one, where it was all, super old school.
So the guys who made those, there's like two names. I can't remember of them, but they're famous for them. And when the writers for Elf were looking for a director, they asked him, or he approached them, And he says, I want it to be in that same style of those. And then that's what sold him. That's what sold him to go with this unknown director. And of course, Elf became a total classic and crushed it.
No kidding.
Yeah.
No. So, I didn't know that.
Yeah. So he's becoming like big time now, especially after Star Wars. He did a phenomenal job.
Yeah. I don't know anybody better these days that are putting out, because it's about story. And I think that, a lot of these directors got away from that. And it's, it was all about the action and the pizzazz and all the like CGI and all. It's like, no, give us a really good story.
Okay. And this is exactly what Cobra Kai did.
Cobra Kai, yeah.
Cobra Kai, okay, if you watch it, it's not the best show. Obviously, it's whatever. It doesn't have the best karate. But they did such a good job with the story and such a good job hitting out to the original fans that it's a classic now. Yeah. It's a cult classic. And they're coming out with another one, aren't they?
Pixar's, I could say, has been consistently, that's like their main core is about the story.
Well, that's what the character. That's what. You slipped his name.
Steve Jobs.
Yes, thank you, thank you for that. That's what Steve Jobs credits the success of Apple to. Was when he created Pixar, what he learned as far as telling a story, that's in that book, Story Brand. He talks about that much of the success that Apple had was after he left and did that. He took a lot of that formula to his advertising and marketing into Apple, and that's what he thinks is responsible for the rise of Apple.
Marketing is so psychological. In fact, I was watching TV the other day, and for some reason we were watching the commercials that go along with it. And there was a computer commercial, and there wasn't a single mention of the performance, the storage, the tech. It was all about
RAM and drive.
It was all about how cool it looks and the story behind it. And Jessica and I were laughing, and we're like, this is so funny because what's really important is what it does. But the commercial doesn't say a single thing
about
that.
That was a big switch with Apple. So Apple went from talking all about what the product was capable of doing and all the specs, and they went from that and trying to create an avatar of people that wanted to be different, people that didn't want to fit in, people that wanted to walk
people
a different
who
walk.
Just really creative.
Wanted to be in a different club, and that is what made that thing explode. And if you look at all like their billboards and ads, like it's always like that. It's never like it does all these features. They don't talk anybody.
No, because they would lose actually.
Yeah, yeah.
Because in fact, they would not succeed.
No,
speaking of different, Adam. This boxing trend that's happening right now.
Oh my God, dude. Are you guys seeing what's happening? And okay, a lot of our influencer friends and stuff that we know are guilty of it too. And it's like ever since the brothers, Jake and
Logan
Paul have did the whole boxing call out.
Yeah.
Like I think everybody who has a somewhat of a following, I now see videos of them like training. Boxing.
Stop it.
Yes.
Dude.
Yes. So just watch, dude.
Oh,
just,
that's gross.
Just watch what we see. I mean, a ton.
Influencer boxing league.
It's so stupid.
Yeah, and I don't want to start yet because I don't.
It's the next fans only.
The unfortunate part is like we have friends that are. It's like it's gotten that crazy that tons of people that we know that we're connected to, are doing it too. Now, maybe they just like to, because I like boxing for like another form of unconventional cardio. Really enjoy the core work that I got from it. Yeah, it was fun. So I'm not like anti that or shitting on anybody that loves to do it for those reasons. I just think it's interesting that you didn't see any of these influencers doing this before, and then now that they've made it popular to call out people. My prediction, okay, to hang in there, this is what we're going to see next, is you're going to see more and more of these
influencers.
Yeah, right? Micro influencers even. You got 100,000 followers like that, calling out some dude that has 200,000, setting up a fight. Even if they're not going to sell it on pay-per-view and be as big as Logan Paul and Jake Paul are, they at least will do it to get attention to build their following and watch that become like a popular thing coming year. So.
Well, whatever.
Stupid.
Whatever. I mean, hey, if the consumers support it, then whatever. The whole thing about boxing for training, for workouts, what used to annoy me about that, because I'm a huge fight fan, big. Like I love boxing. I love boxing history. I love wrestling history. I mean, real Greco-Roman Olympic style wrestling. Of course, the martial arts. I've always been a huge martial art fan, and I've always hated the people that when they do martial arts or fight sports for workouts. And so, because what you end up seeing is terrible technique. There's no focus on the skill or technique. Oh, it's like God. Hit the bag and sweat.
It's just an eyesore.
Yeah, and it's like I haven't done boxing for very long, but I mess with it for a little while, and the workout part's great, but that's the side effect. I wanted to learn the skill of it. So much skill involved in boxing.
This is why I think our buddies over at Box and Burn did such a brilliant.
Exactly.
That was such a brilliant idea because I saw the same thing too. It was like it became a trend in the fitness space to teach boxing. And it's like you got people who don't know anything about boxing.
Just rabbit punching in the air.
Right. And I'm just as guilty of this, right? So I had clients of mine they saw it in the gym, and that's what will you hold pads? I said, I can hold pads for you.
My clients would ask for it all the time.
Right. So I can hold pads, and by no means do I have any real good technique in it whatsoever. And so we would do it like as a form of cardio. And I just think that there was an opportunity for somebody to create a certification for personal trainers around that, and Box and Burn did exactly that.
It's just, I know. And there's just so much skill and technique involved in boxing. You don't need, let me put it this way, if you want to work out and just sweat, you don't need to box. You could do other stuff. But boxing itself as a skill, for someone like me, it's so hard to watch when coaches are teaching it just as a workout, and they're not... And of course, to each their own, so I probably sound like an asshole. Mm. But to me, it's like I value the skill so much. Because when you really learn boxing and when you really study it, I know to the average person, they watch people punch each other. You have no idea how technical it is. Like the skill and the technique involved.
You do when you watch two people who don't know how to box fight each other.
All of a sudden, right?
You ever watch a street fight, it's the fucking ugliest thing ever.
Oh, man.
Yeah, you could see. And it's
so sloppy.
It's always, I think it's always comical when you get these two tough guys that talking big shit. They look all intimidating. let's go. And then they start going. And then you
chest pounding.
And then you watch like
this. And then it becomes, it's just luck. All right, whoever's going to hit the next lucky punch.
Dude catching like wrist across their forehead.
biggest wind up you've ever seen.
A hammer punch.
Oh, I wonder where this is coming from.
I watched this one video of this. It looked like a 60-year-old man who was getting just messed with by some kid, some 20-something-year-old. And the people watching were warning the kid. They're like, you don't want to mess with him. You don't want to mess with him. And he kept messing with them. And he takes a swing in the 60-year-old. And apparently, once you see what happens, the 60-year-old guy used to be a boxer. So he backs up and beep, beep.
Well, I showed you guys that. I don't think I talk about it on the podcast? I know I talked to you guys about my neighbor who is the ex-Ranger.
Oh.
I showed you guys that, right? Yeah. He has a son who's like, he's kind of out there, right? And he came back and he's battling PTSD, so they get into it and stuff. And he caught video of it on his outside camera. And, my dude's like in his 60s, so he's an older guy and he's not in like great condition or anything like that. But, I mean, he's an ex-Ranger, and one of the things he trained is throwing hands. And so, his boy's talking shit. And you see the whole video of him being like trying to be like, no, calm him down, no, no, no. And homeboy shoves him and then throws a punch at him. Dad just steps back, misses the swing, and just one clunk right in the chin, dude, just flattens him.
It's a whole different game.
If you have that skill, you've talked about it before, that power is like the last thing you lose. Maybe you don't have the stamina and to hang in a real fight, but if you learn how to throw a punch, the technique, right?
Communicating it like this might connect to people. It's
precision.
Like, it's like throwing a baseball. Like you can wind up and throw as hard as you want, but someone who knows how to throw a baseball. Mm-hmm. They're just going to be able to throw it farther than you with far more accuracy.
They don't have to use as much effort either.
Yes.
Because they've mastered the technique of it and the precision of, how to utilize and shuttle your force.
Well, here's where it translates into what we do. I mean, that's the same thing I feel like with big complex movements.
Totally.
Yeah. You take a squat or a deadlift, as I'm getting older, those movements are getting easier, not because I'm getting that much stronger. It's just that I'm getting better at the technique.
Exactly.
I've done it so many hundreds, probably thousands of times now that I've figured it out, like how to really move the body. And it just takes a long time to do that.
Just like a well-executed, good technique punch is going to be far more effective than another punch that's just whatever. A well-executed, excellent technique squat is going to produce far better results for you than just go under the bar and squat until you fatigue. It's like it's almost like a different exercise. That's why when people tell me squats don't work well for me, deadlifts, I don't like them, they don't really do anything for me. Mm. I'm always like, okay, let me see how they look and what you're doing, because when you do them right and you've got good technique and good practice, they produce a tremendous results, mm-hmm. you know, for you.
So 2021 is going to be the time for sloppy fights.
Yeah.
That's what it, what, that's remember what it sounded that, like. What was that show that was popular for a little while? It was yellow and black.
The tough guy competition?
Yes, yeah. Oh, was, yeah. What was it? Was that what it was called?
Is that what it was?
That's where Butterbean.
That's the one where I saw this guy I know just get lit up and we were all just like, yay.
Is that, that's what Butterbean came from? Remember Butterbean?
Oh, yeah. I love Butterbean. Yeah.
He actually became pro.
Yeah.
Yeah, he actually.
Well, dude, what you would see and what happened is you'd see a bunch of these, like, you know, weekend warrior guys that think they're tough going in there. And then every once in a while, you see one dude who actually has some skill going there and he would just light somebody up.
Fighting sucks, man. Like, you get in a real, you start throwing real.
Yeah, it always sounds like a good idea. You know, it's just like, really? Have you been in one?
There's way better ways to boost your social media.
Hey,
get a fight.
Sal, I wanted to bring up, so you brought up the stimulus checks. We talked the other day about people leaving California. It's the new year right now, so 2021. I want to make some predictions on the economic side. So what do you see this year happening as far as business, stocks, housing? What do you think we were in store for 2021?
It all depends. Because of all the money they injected into the economy, all the money they printed, I think you'll see asset inflation. I don't think interest rates are going to go up anytime soon.
Yeah, you have to explain what
assets being like houses.
No, but stuff. Explain why economists predict that to happen in layman's terms. Like, that's great. We can say that all day long, but it's like, okay, what does that mean?
Yeah, what does that mean?
Yeah, what does that mean?
And so because there's just more money available, even though it's not connected to more productivity or more products. It's just money, right? They just printed money. Because there's more money and it's looser and easier to access with lower interest rates, that means more people are going to be able to buy, especially people who didn't get hit so hard by COVID. They'll be able to invest and buy more things. So you have more money going in and competing for the same number of houses or stocks. And so you get what's called inflation, meaning the price of houses, the price of stocks will keep going up until, you know, they come crashing down because of, you know, what they're doing. So I think that we're going to continue to probably see that. Here's the big if the vaccine does its job and you start to see people feel confident, businesses feel confident, things open back up, then I think you're going to see this huge boom in productivity. People are going, you know, go back to work and things are stopped. But that's a big if.
I just read an article that said that there's some of these guys are predicting that we are going to see like the roaring 20s.
Yeah.
After everything, right? So after this, all the shutdown, the regulations, everything's lifted and
we're— Get that old-timey music again.
Well, yeah. I don't think it's that part of it, but I think it's the spending, the partying, the free-for-all. Like, I think we're going to see that happen.
You know what came after the roaring 20s?
What's that?
Great Depression.
Yeah, I know.
I'm serious.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, think about it. It's winding up to be that too, because if you—
history repeats itself.
We all agree on the asset inflation, right? I think stocks and housing, I think as crazy as it may sound, but these, you know, the condo I live in right now is $1 million condo. It's nothing, dude. It's a it's literally 1,700 square feet, 3-bedroom, 2.5-bath. You know, nothing fancy. I'm attached to somebody else.
And it keeps going up, even though supposedly people are unemployed.
Right. So, I don't think it's too far of a fetch to think that thing will be $1.5 to $2 million in the next 5 to 10 years. Yeah. And that's just crazy to think that.
Yeah.
It is crazy.
And I mean, look, here's the deal. When the stock market is at record highs, and yet we supposedly have unemployment and businesses, you know, small businesses going out of business, that doesn't match. Yeah. So there's some funny stuff going on, and it's really like—
It's not that. I think you hit it. We could expand on it a little bit more. Is that when you take that much money? So before this stimulus package, okay, the $2 trillion that we did before, and I shared this on the podcast that all the money in the circulation in the United States,
like a large percentage of it was
22% of it was created this year. That was before this next $900 billion. So you got to think that 25%+ of the money that's in circulation right now was created out of thin air, meaning that it's not attached to any sort of goods or labor.
Yeah.
So it's just going into the pockets.
Just printed.
And what happens? 80% of those people that get these 600 or 2,000, whatever we end up landing on checks, believe it or not, some people will use that check, of course, to feed their families, get their PG&E bills back up. But then there's a big portion of people that will go buy Xboxes, that will buy more things on Amazon, that will just pump it right back into the economy that's ran by all the rich capitalist people that have already been. So you're just going to make the rich richer who can go buy a condo for $1.5, $2 million and don't really give a shit.
Well, all the investors see this and they're betting on that. So what they're doing is they're investing, knowing that they're going to continue to. Because here's the deal. When things inflate, the way you protect yourself is by buying things or investing in things that will inflate.
That will increase,
If savings actually is in a situation where there's lots of inflation, saving your money is not necessarily a smart strategy. I hate to say that, but if I have $100 saved and the value of that money continues to go down because inflation goes up, the reality is I'm losing money. Yeah. Even though I'm saving money, I'm losing money.
Yeah.
And so it's encouraging spending, encouraging buying these things.
Tangible assets.
Yeah, so it's a weird situation. I know Peter Schiff is just spinning right now.
Oh, I bet.
I told you guys. Just
been
wait.
Been telling you guys.
The big crash.
For decades.
Yeah, so we'll see what happens.
Are you still watching Bitcoin too? Did I see it start to come back down again?
I think people, let me see. I'll go check it. It was up for a second. I think it got up to 23,000 a coin.
Yeah, it was rolling for a minute there, but I think it's coming back down to earth again, isn't it?
Yeah. No, it's still high though, dude.
Dude.
It's still high.
Did you guys know that Apple's still trying to make a car?
What do you mean a car?
They're still, like a long time ago, they showed, like, I think it was on one of those magazines, like, the tech magazines that they were coming out with the Apple car. And it was, like, going to be electric and all this stuff. And, like, so autonomous or whatever you call it, where it drives itself. So I guess they're still pursuing that. They're still pursuing a self-driving car. And I guess back in, I don't remember how many years ago it was, but like Elon had actually proposed to Tim Cook to buy Tesla. And this was at like 1/10 of their valuation now.
Wow. So
you missed out on that one.
So here's what I'd say. The first company to create a fleet of autonomous cars that you can just access through an app, that company's going to explode and change the world.
Well, so that's what Apple's banking
on. So what's your thoughts? I look at Apple, Uber, and Tesla as like the leading three.
Yep, same here.
Definitely. Who do you think has the best advantage?
Amazon, I would put up there also. I would also put Amazon. They haven't said anything that they're going to do.
They're always
like that.
A sleeper.
The reason why I think those other three, because the other three have already been building tech and things in that direction, right? Uber has got the force, right? Yeah. They've got the connection of the people that would utilize it, the app connection. That's already that side of it.
I got a
they have the UI down.
Yeah.
I got a dark horse for you. Who? So what company has mapped out more of the earth in detail?
Google.
Yeah.
Google already, so if you have this autonomous car, think about the value of everything that they've already been doing. Is seeing where everything is and having all this.
True. Apple tried. I mean, their maps aren't quite as good as Google's, but they've definitely.
They've got that, it. So. Yeah.
That's going to be life-changing, by the way.
But then you have Tesla with the tech and the car and the ability to communicate to the software. Yeah.
It's going to be life-changing. Yeah, no one's going to own cars, I swear to God, because.
Tesla's car's the best, but, the software and all that, the back end, I would say Apple.
Dude, nobody's going to own cars. It'll be cheaper to just call your car, pick you up, drive off. You don't have insurance. You have to pay for gas. I read an article where they were figuring it out. It'll cost something like $1,000 a year to be able to travel just by calling your car. Mm-hmm. That's way cheaper than owning a car, paying for its service and all that stuff. It's going to change everything when you can do that. Think about the design of cities, the garages that we have. That space is going to be turned into something else.
Oh, yeah, and work. Our entire work environment has changed already. Now imagine we have like self-driving
cars. When you look at car payments, insurance, washing your cars, gassing your cars, all those things for tight, you can't get away with anything under $5,000 a year. So like if they can figure that out for $1,000, it's game over. It's just a matter of time.
It's game. And think about the inside of the car designed right now for the driver. When it's not that and it's just picking
you
up.
It's going to be a little lounge.
It'll be whatever
office.
Whatever you want.
This is why I bet on Uber, because I feel like the natural progression to the autonomous driving car or whatever that is the first everybody using like Uber, with a driver, with an actual
they've
driver.
They've got the app. They've got
everything. Right. They've already got this breakaway from using. Like what I see happening is Uber coming out with a membership that you pay $1,000 a year, like you're saying, or whatever fixed number it is. And everybody does the math and goes, holy shit, I can guarantee an Uber car to pick me up everywhere for this. I don't have, that's crazy.
Actually, now that I think about it, because what'll probably, because here's the big bottleneck is the regulations, right?
Right. Yeah. So that will be first.
What'll probably happen is they'll say autonomous cars are fine. However, for the time being, there has to be a driver present.
Well, they're doing that already.
Right? So Uber could do that. Uber could literally say, do you want to be an Uber, supervisor?
Right.
So now you're not a driver, but you just got to sit in there
early
just in case.
Adopter.
Exactly. Just in case something happens.
That's why I think Uber leads this.
Huh? Yeah. So they're already doing this with semi-trucks. And, yeah. And you know, and they're starting to basically, so they have somebody piloting the truck, but they're letting the steering wheel kind of take over and testing their systems to see how well they perform.
That's going to, you know, autonomous trucks are going to lower the cost of goods.
Shipping and all
like
that.
Like crazy. Yeah. Yeah. And shipping like crazy. Yeah. It's going to be
drones,
insane.
Drones, you know, from there.
Which so is they all
can just
that
drive
is
just and then just deliver.
More shit we can buy.
Yeah. With it our is. Stimulus checks.
I need more stuff. Yeah.
That's what's gonna happen, dude. It's worse.
They gotta get creative, you know, with like pitching stuff at us. You know, there better be some cool stuff to buy.
Yeah. First question is from Anton Alesna. What are your guys' favorite workout splits?
Don't say full body. Well, that wouldn't be a split.
Yeah.
So
well, okay. So
we're running body. One right now. So yeah. We should share what we're running right now.
Yeah. So okay. So first and foremost, you know, and I'll stand by this. For most people, a full body. You know, 3-day workout is superior. Just works best for most people.
Yeah.
That being said, there's some benefits to splits, especially for people who are advanced and who are doing high volume workouts, because it, you know, a full body high volume workout can take 2 hours plus. So splitting the body up in that case makes sense. One of my favorite splits is the one that we're doing right now, which you find in MAPS split, and that is called a push pull leg split. So essentially, it's a 6-day-a-week routine, and what you do is day one, you work the push muscles, which would be chest, shoulders, and triceps. The next day would be back, biceps, and then the next day would be legs, and you would probably throw core in there with your legs. And then you would repeat that cycle for the next 3 days, so every body part is getting
with
hit.
A one-day break in between or at the end? One of the
at the end or yeah. In between. Yeah. Right. I like to do it at the end, I go 6 days and then off and then do it again. And
right, right. That's
it.
The same thing. So I love splits like this. And the biggest knock that I have on splits versus full body is just the consistency of being able to train 5 or 6 days a week.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And if you miss a day, you're screwed.
That's why.
Yeah.
Exactly. Exactly. You miss a day, and now that throws off next week, and you're starting it on a different day. And so something gets less attention than something else. So one of your body parts suffer. The body part that tends to suffer on most people is the one they like to train the least. Yep. It's just natural. This is human behavior. And that's why we always push the full body. Because here's what's great. If you do a 2 or 3 day a week full body routine and you miss one day, you're okay.
You just hit the whole body.
You still hit the whole body and you still are starting the same place next week without skipping a beat. Yeah. Where when you run a split, it just takes a little bit more. Now, that being said, if you are somebody who is religious about going to the gym 5, 6, 7 days a week and you never miss, then splits are great. Yeah. There's nothing wrong with splits.
Oh yeah, it's fun if you just love like hanging out in the gym all the time. Yeah. And I get that too. Like it's totally a hangout and it's something people look forward to a lot. So it kind of fits within that culture of it. But yeah, it's funny. Doing this is such a shell shock on my body because it's just something I don't typically do. And it's definitely like, for me, it's good to venture outside of my comfort zones and do something like this. My body will respond, you know, great. As a result of it.
Yeah, now here's what studies will show, and this kind of supports even my experience training people, that the total volume for the week that you want to do per body part for most people is anywhere between 10 to 20 total sets. So 10 to 20 total sets seems to be where most people respond the best. Obviously, 20 being more for people who are really advanced. Nutrition is good. Sleep is good. Good recovery ability. 10 more for, you know, beginners and all that stuff. As far as frequency of training the body parts, here's what's interesting. Studies show that the ideal frequency that you should train a body part, regardless of the total volume, so in other words, even if you control total volume, the body parts respond best to 2 to 3 times a week. One time a week, you're going to gain less strength, less muscle, less results than if you train a body part twice a week. So what that means is if you're training your chest on Monday for 20 sets, you're better off training chest twice a week, 10 sets each time.
Right.
That 2 to 3 times a week seems to produce the most. And in my experience, this is totally true. If when clients were hitting the whole body, however we broke up the split, 2 to 3 days a week, we got way better results, even if the volume was totally same.
Well,
same thing for me.
What I do like also about splits is it's a little bit easier to manage the soreness and overreaching part because, like, so we trained today was our leg day. And it's been 4 days since I trained legs, and so I've got good enough rest. Where when we do a MAPS anabolic routine, if you overreached on Monday, you're right back there on Wednesday again. So you don't get as much recovery time. So I felt great today lifting, where had I had to lift legs again 2 days ago, well, then I would have had to modify my intensity more and lower it because I'm hitting it at more frequently. So I do like that with the split, is it gives me a little bit more recovery time before I go after the muscle, which also allows me to kind of get after a little bit more. So if you like that, if you like kind of getting after it, you tend to lean that way more, where you do more in your workout than you probably should have. Splits tend to work out really well for that. It doesn't bode well for a full body routine 2 or 3 times a week.
Yeah, you need to consider the context of everything and be honest with yourself. And again, for most people, just long term, full body just works and produces the best results, the best consistency, the best strength, fat loss. Most MAPS programs have some variation of a full body type approach. But we do have programs where it's more of that bodybuilder split, like MAP split. But again, you're working out 6 days a week. There's 1 day off. That's it.
And I really think almost everybody, I don't care who you are, even if you like splits, if you're getting back into the swing of things, like you've taken a break because of the holidays, even if it's only been 2 weeks, like if you've done 2 weeks or more of a break, that everybody is better off starting with that kind of full body first. Sure. And the reason why it's okay for us to move into the split where we are now is that's how I was training by myself before you guys and we got together. Mm-hmm. I was training 1 to 2 days a week full body. And that's what was maintaining me kind of where I was at. Now, when we all got together and started working out, I can transition into that and be okay. If I would have jumped, let's say I hadn't worked out in a month or two, jumping into the split routine you guys would have, and you still got me. I'm probably the sorest out of the three of us because I've been training at probably the least amount of volume. And just these workouts alone where we've had, 2 or 3 exercises for a muscle group, I mean, that's so much more that I've done in a workout in a long time that I'm really sore.
Right.
Next question is from Carlos V. U.S., what do you do on a rest day when you want to go to the gym?
Mobility.
Yeah, rest, I used to
what
think.
What do I do with myself?
I used to think rest meant nothing, do nothing. I got to sit on the couch and let my muscles build or whatever.
Right.
The reality is that's actually slowing down recovery and slowing down progress. No joke. You're better off moving to recover than you are doing nothing. The only time it's a good idea to do nothing is when you're really messed up. Like you're so sore that you're inflamed, borderline rhabdo, issues, then do nothing. Otherwise, a rest day, the best thing you could do on a rest day is to move. So if I went to the gym, if I really want to work out, if I want to lift weights on my rest day, here's what I would do. I'd go to the gym and get a real light pump on things.
Yeah.
That's all. Just go to the gym.
Take some rubber bands. I love those for that reason. And just go through mobility flows. There's a lot you can do. And again, activity, it helps to foster a faster recovery anyways. And so you get benefit from that. And it's good to train yourself too, that you can go to the gym and you don't have to smash it every single time. There's a lot you can do. And there's a lot of body parts that you can cover even on those off days.
I like talking about this topic because I was so off when I was younger. When I was younger, I had this idea that if I was still sore, that it would be a waste of time going in and lifting that muscle group. Because my thought was, okay, I tore and broke down muscle. It's sore, so then I know it's still recovering. It hasn't fully recovered. If I go back in the gym and I just train it again, then I'm just going to do more damage and I'm not going to get the full benefits of the recovery. And so my thought was always like, oh, I won't train that muscle group again until I feel it's been fully recovered. And the truth is that's not ideal. In fact, going and lifting that same exact muscle that's sore, but just a much lower intensity, will not only speed up recovery, but I'll build more muscle that way. And so now I have just a total different philosophy around that. So if I come into a training session and I'm really sore in an area that I was planning on working, I'm still working it. I just modify intensity. So if you can squat 200, 300, 400 pounds, there's nothing wrong with squatting 135 for the day. Mm-hmm. There's nothing wrong with slowing down the tempo, going really deep, and just getting a nice pump. I mean, honestly, our leg workout, Sal and I's today, looked more like that because I still was recovering from the last one. I wasn't fully, so I was like, I don't need to go hammer it really hard, but I do want to get a nice pump and get a workout. So, I'm doing goblet squats, holding a 70-pound. That's nothing. If I can squat 300-plus pounds, doing goblet squats with 70 pounds holding or walking lunges. What do we do with walking lunges? Like 60, 70 pounds? Nothing. It wasn't really, really strenuous, but I know it'll be good. Like I feel already the pump from it. I know that my body will respond to it. I know that I'll recover even faster because of it, but I didn't have to go in there and hammer it.
In fact, sometimes I purposely do that when a muscle group is too sore. Sometimes when it's really, really sore, I'll grab some bands, do some light movement, and it just recovers faster. Yeah, it facilitates recovery.
Opens your bag up.
And I feel much better.
The next question is from the Murphy Motive. How do you know if you're too sick to work out? What symptoms and how severe must they be to know that you shouldn't work out?
Well, good rule of thumb is obviously if you have a fever, don't work out. Right? Anytime you run a temperature, don't do any exercise. Exercise temporarily depresses or suppresses the immune system, and you can actually kick an illness into high gear. I've done this many times myself where I'm definitely sick, and then I go in the gym stubbornly, take some caffeine, push through a workout, and I got way sicker the day after. Here's the other rule of thumb that I say. If you're feeling kind of not good, you don't have a temperature, do things in the gym or at home that are making you feel better. So that might look like a walk outside.
Yeah, stretching. Sauna. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So I don't do that anymore. Like if I at all feel even under the weather, I'm not training.
You just learned your lesson so many times.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. Because there's been many times where I'm like, am I getting sick? I don't feel great, but I think I'm fine. I'm gonna go train because I'm in a rhythm, right? I'm in a rhythm with my training. I don't want to miss it, you know. And so I go, and I would say more often than not, I go in, I train, and then I get really sick afterwards. Then you get
worse symptoms as a result of training.
Yeah, and the way I look at it is, you know, if I don't get sick that often, so it's very rare. And if that happens in the middle of me being consistent and I'm feeling under the weather, honestly, what I do now, and Sal, you're the one that got me using the it's elderberry. I know I always mess with it.
Yeah,
the elderberry, the zinc, and the vitamin C. Like I start to and hitting the green juice with Organifi. I start pounding that, drinking tons of water. I stay home for a couple of days, and what I have found trying to do things like that, I end up either getting a very mild cold, if one at all, or I end up beating it. 2 or 3 days, I'm back to training hard again.
Yeah, it almost seems these days, even now, you know, like how conscious you have to be about like any kind of symptoms or anything. Just stay home, you know, like let's keep these gyms open if we can. But you got to go through it to really realize it. You're not getting a whole lot of benefit by just pushing through. It just doesn't take you, you know, through whatever plateau you think you're going
to
have.
Well, you just have to look at the risk versus reward. 1 to 2 workouts being missed is not going to lose a bunch of gains. You're nowhere are you going to make a bunch of gains from 1 or 2 workouts. But what could really set you back is getting so sick you feel miserable, you don't want to walk in the gym for a week, and your diet's off and everything. That could set you back pretty good.
I can't tell you how many times I've done that. Where I'll get no rest because maybe I'm on a trip or something, and I get home and I'm exhausted, but I'm supposed to work out. And I'm like, I feel like I'm kind of getting sick, and I haven't gotten good sleep. You know what I'm going to do? I'm going to, you know, take a pre-workout and go hit the gym anyway.
Go sweat it out.
And then the next day, I'm like, done. I'm fucked. And then I'm sick for a week. And
I used to hear people tell me all the time they would go in the steam room or sauna to try and sweat it out. Yeah.
Well, sauna's got some benefit potentially. Now, the problem is if you have a bad fever and you go in the sauna, that's deadly. But the sauna itself, steamy, it's almost like giving your body a fake
artificial
fever. Yeah, and it can actually boost your immune system, but you have to use it pretty intelligently. If you're super sick, don't go in there. Yeah. It makes yourself pass out.
Next question is from Iron Mikey 19. What did 2020 teach you?
Oh, God.
A lot of stuff.
I'll tell you, the biggest thing I learned was that for sure lizard people are running the world.
Oh, yeah. Dude, every conspiracy I've ever heard
were in a video game.
Yeah, like this. Yeah, I kind of thought it, but now I know for sure. Like this is there's a bunch of weird shit going on.
Yeah, 2020 made me despise politics even more than I already did.
Yes.
Like, you couldn't hate it more.
I thought I hated it. Yeah, I thought I already hated it on enough. But after 2020, I hate it even more.
I couldn't believe people could get so tribal again. It was just so fascinating to watch, how easily people just are manipulated. Yeah. It's crazy.
For me, I mean, okay, all joking aside, and this is a lesson that anytime something's challenging, I think is there for you. It doesn't mean you're going to learn it. And that's acceptance. Acceptance is just constant, right? You accept every single moment. And 2020, I had to... You know, I'm a bit of a hypochondriac, right? And so what were we dealing with? A pandemic. And so initially, I was very anxious about it. And so I had to accept that. And then I had to accept that I'm not going to be able to travel and do certain things. And I had to accept that I couldn't see family members as much as I wanted to. And just over and over again, I had to accept kind of things as they were. But it is a valuable lesson because life, you know, and this is me being like, you know, super wise about it, but the reality is I struggle with it. Mm-hmm. But the wise part of me is like, look, you know, life is about accepting what you can't control.
Anything can happen. And I think that was very, very much displayed. 2020 was just, nobody saw it coming, you know, but guess what? That's life. You know, you got to just always know there's uncontrollables that could happen at any moment. And, you know, we were definitely living in really like it. You go back and appreciate like where you were leading into that year.
Yep. Yeah. What I really took away was I value human connection on another level than I probably ever did. Like, you know, I miss our staff being in here like on a daily basis. I didn't, you know, we have this virtual business now. And it made me realize how much I don't want that. Like, I don't want a business that's ran where, you know, all the people that work for it can Zoom in and Skype and stuff like that. It's not the same. I mean, half of what makes this business fun and enjoyable is actually creating jobs for all these people, mm-hmm. seeing them work every single day in a fitness business that's fun. And I like to think that we're fun bosses to work with and for. And so, yeah, I really miss it. And plus, it's really hard to build a culture and motivate people. You know, business has slowed down the last like 3 to 4 months. And, you know, it's normally when you get your people in here, you can kind of rally the troops and get them fired up and motivated to like really take it up a notch. It's really hard to do over a Zoom call to make that type of same connection that you make that I would make when I would walk with a staff member outside for 10 minutes and talk about their family and what's going on with them. Like, it's just not the same doing that over a telephone or a Zoom call. So I really value that. And that's on the work side. And then also I value that more now than ever with the family side. Like, so it definitely kicked up my communication with all my siblings and family. So I'm talking more to them than I ever have because I miss them. I miss being able to get together and it be okay that all of us, you know, congregate in the same house and hang out and be together. So I find myself valuing that more. And so when we kind of get out of this, I think that I'll make an effort as like one of the leaders in the family to try and get us together more often, because you never know when it could disappear mm-hmm. and we can't. So mm-hmm. It taught me that. It also taught me too, like, luckily I've kind of gone, and I've shared this on the podcast, like my story with finances, like my insecurities of it early in my life and then working so hard to get to a certain point and then trying to, or spending all my money to look the part of being very successful to kind of coming full circle where, you know, now I'm almost like a miser, right? So I feel like this, you never know when something like this is going to happen. And part of why this time didn't really stress me out as much as I've had some friends and people connected to me was because I was prepared for it. You know, financially I have been better with my money in the last, you know, 5 to 8 years than I ever have. And honestly, where we were looking at the worst case scenario we could happen, oh my God, nobody buys any mind pump programs anymore, listeners stop listening, will I be okay? And the reality was like, yeah, we'll be totally fine, we'll be all right. It would suck, but I wouldn't be wondering how we were going to pay our bills or keep things going. So, you know, it just taught me the value of that, of making sure that, you know, you're not living this paycheck to paycheck and you're thinking that, you know, even if it's a great ride right now and money's coming in and you're doing well, that can all end mm-hmm. in a single snap of the fingers. And so to be thinking that with forward thinking always, and that thinking that this could end, I think that a lot of people were woken up with that are, especially your entrepreneurs out there that mm-hmm. were operating businesses yep. that did not have enough income to go. And that, you know, it's a hard thing to say to somebody who is really struggling to keep their lights on right now. But that is one of the things that, you know, a lot of the economists were saying was just like, man, you know, as a country, we've been taught to that, you know, debt is totally okay and living paycheck to paycheck and on credit cards and, you know, it's fine. We're just it's different today than it was in our parents' time. You know, like I remember hearing that Dave Ramsey conversation about his lesson from his dad who would, you know, they would be hammering or pulling apart nails from a deck and his dad would be saving the nails, you know, because he doesn't know if because he came from the Great Depression time of when he couldn't even afford to buy a nail. And so just having that mentality where you would just throw that away today. Right. So, you know, trying to reframe things like that, just because things are good financially for you at the time, is to not get out of control with your spending and thinking that it'll never end. In fact, having a mindset that this could end tomorrow, and if it were to, what should I be doing with my finances?
Very good. Look, Mind Pump is recorded on video as well as audio. Come find us on YouTube, Mind Pump Podcast. You can also find all of us on Instagram. You can find Justin at Mind Pump Justin. You can find me at Mind Pump Sal, Adam at Mind Pump Adam, and Doug at Mind Pump Doug. They did studies on people with seasonal affective disorder, and they found that when they supplemented with vitamin D, a significant percentage of them saw a dramatic reduction in their seasonal depression. One study said as much as 40% of Americans are become deficient in vitamin D during the winter. This may...